Thank you. You may be seated. May I take a minute before the choir comes. Wanted to send a special gift to Dr. Busby, as well as to Render Connect. We have not done that yet, and maybe you hadn't had the opportunity to give towards, our goal was to do it by the end of last month, but we didn't. So we do want to give you an opportunity today when you give, if you can help with that project, would you please do so? And would you please mark it as special missions gift? Mm-hmm. Or somehow mark it so that when the men back there count, they can know what to do. So that which has been given to Peter is not taken and given to Paul. Quiet.
Amen.
Gospel of John, chapter 12. John, chapter 12. I'd like to ask you all to stand as we read the Word of God. We'll read verses 1 through 19 responsively, and then read verse 19 together. John chapter 12. John chapter 12, reading responsively, verses 1 through 19, and we'll read 19 together. Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead.
There made him supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him.
Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the odor of the ointment.
Then said one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's friend, which would betray him.
Why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence? And given to the poor?
This he said not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief, and had the bag, and bare what was put therein.
Then said Jesus, let her alone. Against the day of my burying hath she kept this.
For the poor always ye have with you, but me ye have not always.
Much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there, and they came not to, for Jesus' sake only, but that they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead.
But the chief priests consulted them, they might put Lazarus also to death.
Because that by reason of him, men of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus.
On the next day, much people that were come to the feast
took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, blessed the King of Israel, that cometh in the name of the Lord.
And Jesus went and found the young man, set thereon, as it is written.
Fear not, daughters of Zion, behold, the King cometh, sitting on a ass colt.
These things understood not his disciples at the first, but when Jesus was glorified, in him among the days, these things had been written down him, they had done these things unto him.
The people therefore, that was with him when he called Lazarus out of his grave and raised him from the dead, bear record.
For this cause the people also met him,
for that they heard that he had done this miracle.
Let us read 19 together. The Pharisees therefore said among themselves, perceive ye how ye prove nothing? Behold, the world is gone after him. Thank you. You may be seated. That we like to sing this morning, when I survey the wondrous cross and lead me. Would you please stand? Thank you. The sheet, lead me to Calvary. Let's sing the first and the last stanza. May be seated.
City called glory, so bright and so fair. When I entered the gates, I cried, "Holy!" The angels all welcome me there. They led me from mansion to mansion, and oh, sights I saw. But I said, I want to see Jesus, the one who died for all. I thought as I entered the city, my loved ones knew me well. They showed me all over heaven. The scenes were too numerous to tell. I saw Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I saw Mark, Luke, and Timothy. But I said, just let me see Jesus. He's the one who died for me. Then I bowed on my knees and cried, holy, holy, Lord, holy. I clapped my hands and said, glory, glory to the Son of God. I thought, when I saw my dear Savior, there seated on the throne. Oh, the wonder that he could love me and call me his very own. I bowed down and worshiped my Savior, my friend of Calvary. And I wanted to praise him forever for saving a sinner like me. Then I bowed down on my knees and cried, holy, holy, Lord, holy. I clapped my hands and sing glory, glory to the Son of God.
Thank you, Ernestine, for your ministry to us this morning. Thank you, choir. Thank you, Karen. Thank you, Jim, for interpreting for those who are deaf. And I welcome each one of you here this morning. My heart is full The song chokes me up. Really does. If you will turn in your Bible to the Gospel of John, chapter 12, the scripture that we read. And I want to talk this morning, I guess, from the subject of how much really is too much when it comes to giving to the Lord. How much is too much? We are confronted with a woman whose name was Mary. We don't have an awful lot of information about her, but her name was Mary. And then we're confronted with a crowd that cried, "Hosanna to the Son of David." But apparently they really didn't mean it. And we're confronted with a Savior who says, "I'm willing to give all to redeem us, to take us to heaven, so that, yes, we can see Mark, Luke, and John, but that's not the important one. Those are not the important ones. We want to see Jesus."
Yes.
Look at the text, if you will. John 12 and verse 1. "Then 6 days before the Passover." And incidentally, the time when Passover falls this year is pretty close to where it was when it fell in 33 AD, somewhere around March the 27th is when this took place in 33 AD. "Came to Bethany with Lazarus, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead." And this Lazarus is he's a pest to these people. They want to put him to death. Jesus had raised him from the dead. They accused the people of believing on Jesus because this dead man is now alive because of the power of Christ. In verse 10, and you see him again in verse 17, and you see him in verses 1 and in 2. "There they went. There they made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Then said one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, 'Why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor?' This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the bag and bare what was in it. Then said Jesus, 'Let her alone. Against the day of my bearing hath she kept this. For the poor always you have with you, but me you have not always.'" Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you would superintend over us today. Bind every spirit that is contrary to your will and to your way. And may the Holy Spirit of God take the feeble words of your servant today and apply them to our individual hearts so that we go down from this place with a renewed vision and a new determination that we're going to live for the Lord Jesus Christ and allow him to work in us and through us for his glory and honor. Keep us alert, Lord, I pray. May we be attentive. And may the name of Jesus Christ be lifted up And may those who are believers in Christ be encouraged. And those who know not the Savior, Lord, today, I pray that they would put their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. We ask it again in our Lord's name. Amen. Here we come to a situation where there is a woman by the name of Mary. And it's kind of obvious that she was single, because there's no indication ever that this woman had a husband. She lived with another single woman by the name of Martha. And she had a brother by the name of Lazarus. Of course, Lazarus had died. And our Lord Jesus Christ now has brought him back from the tomb. And here is this single woman. Perhaps she was of nobility, or either she had inherited a great fortune because of what she did. If you will notice in chapter 12 and verse 1, it says here that Lazarus was there, but notice verse 3. Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Now here's this girl, perhaps poor, I don't know, but perhaps she had saved this to give to the master. But this spikenard, this little jar of ointment, of perfume, was very, very costly. They had imported it from India, and it's unadulterated. I mean, it is pure. I mean, this is the best on the market. And here is this lady in Bethany called Mary who owns this spikenard. And I want you to notice what she does now, recognizing who Jesus is and recognizing that Palm Sunday is right around the corner from us now. I want to do something that is significant. I want to invest something that people will hear about for as long as time goes on. And we hear this today. How much was it worth? Well, I have been told that it was worth 300 pounds, and that the cost of a common man's day's labor was £1 for one day's work. So here this woman, when you consider the Sabbath and the times when they had rest, here she brings an entire year's salary. And of the best possible perfume there ever was. And here she comes to our blessed Lord, and I want you to notice, she gave the best that she had, but notice also, it says that it was very costly, and she took it, and she anointed the feet of Jesus. Now people anointed the heads, you know, Psalms 23 tells us that he anointeth my head with oil. They anointed the hands, and normally those were slaves who were given the responsibility of anointing the feet of people, but normally anointing was on the head or on the hand. But I want you to notice this single woman, what she does. She has no towel, but she does something that was unusual for the Jewish community in those days. I mean, for a Jewish woman to somehow take her hair out of the curl. Not only Jewish women, I mean, we don't do that now, do we? You get them hairdos, you're gonna take that hair down and wipe somebody's feet with it? Yeah, this is unusual. Because the report had gone out, you know, that loose women would do a thing like that.
But here she takes the hair, she takes it down, and she takes that ornament, and she puts it in her hair, and she takes her hair, and she uses her hair as a towel, and she washes the feet of the master. Boy, what sacrifice. Can you see this woman? Can you see the men standing around? What's wrong with this loose woman? What is she asking for? But she takes her hair and she wipes his feet, and the house is filled with odor. How much are we willing to give to the master? You know, we hear it all the time. God blesses his people, and in many instances, having been blessed by the Lord, we take what God has given to us and we use it for ourselves. Hello? When there's one principle that we ought to recognize is this: God blesses us so that we can bless others. Hello? If God has blessed you, he didn't just bless you so that you could keep it all to yourself. Amen. And hoard what you have and brag about how smart you are or how good you are at your job. God blesses you so that you can get down into the gutter and try to bless somebody else. And here's a woman who perhaps had inherited this spike knot, this nod that came from India, a long ways away, imported. And she said, yes, this is mine. But what I'm going to do with this that is mine, I am going to humble myself. I'm going to take this and wash the feet of the Savior. And I'm going to do it with my hair. What a gift. What a sacrifice. You see, as I said, Jewish women never took their hair loose in public. That indicate a loose life. And here she was single, and yet she gives to the Lord her best. A few days ago, I turned another birthday. And I'm thankful to God for him having given me another birthday. Don't ask how old I am, because I'm not going to tell you, but I may be older than what I look. All right. No. That's not backwards. There's an assignment for you, and I won't turn you over there now. I'll just refer to it. Psalms 90 is a psalm that deals with time. And the thing that it does is it contrasts physical life with the eternal God who never changes. I said I wasn't going to turn you over there, but some of you have gone anyway. Look at Psalms 90. Now here is, as I thank God for having given me another birthday, here's what I encourage us to do. Look at Psalms 90 and verse 2. It says, talking about God, now this eternal God who has created us and who gives us time, before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hadst formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art who? God. But notice your next verse, and the rest of the psalm is basically telling us how frail mankind is, that your days are numbered. It's 70 years, and if by reason of strength, it's labor and sorrow, it's pain, it's agony, we're falling down, we're falling apart. I mean, for the rest of the psalm, that's what it's talking about. And basically it says in verse 12, so teach us to number our days. You didn't have to get up this morning. He touched you with the finger of love this morning and brought you back to consciousness, and he didn't have to do it. And so God says, in the midst of this thing, as a human being, you're here for a very short time. You ought to invest what you have in the kingdom work of the Lord Jesus Christ. You ought to use what you have to bless somebody else. And as you use what you have to bless someone else, God will give you more. Amen. Oh, I'm a living witness. He'll do it.
Amen.
Use what you have to bless others. And God says here, teach us, Lord, to number our days.
Yes.
That we may apply our hearts under wisdom.
Yes.
It's easy for us to say, oh, I'm young, I'm going to live a long time. Well, it's not necessarily guaranteed. I mean, don't bank on it. I had a friend who followed me into Bible school when I went to Cleveland, Ohio, when I went to the Baptist School of the Bible, the greatest thing that happened to me, little old Bible school. Amen. He had a brother who went to Mississippi, and he pulled around a truck. He thought he was going to pull around the truck, but he got out there, and lo and behold, eternity met him. The man who preached his funeral used this verse. Teach us to number our days so that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. The 168 hours that we have every week, huh? The clock that continues to tick, we ought to look at it and say to the Lord, every waking moment of the day is time that you have given to me, and I want to invest it for the glory and honor of the Lord Jesus Christ, even as Mary did when she wiped, she washed the feet of the Master with her hair. Now you read the rest of the psalm, and it just tells you where you can find happiness in life. And that's not my sermon this morning, but you read the rest of the psalm, and it will tell you where you can find happiness. Man is like the flower. Oh, okay, blooms in the morning, but just wait a few days. It's soon cut off, and we fly away. So I say to the Lord, Lord, take my life. I may not have an awful lot to give. I know that my talents are limited. I understand that. But God, what you have given to me, I bring it back to you, and I want to wash your feet with it. And giving to the Lord the best that I have is not giving too much to him. I want to bounce from Mary here, although an awful lot could be said about this whole thing. But I want to bounce from Mary, and I want you to look at verse 12 of John's gospel. You see, we have to be careful with the accolades that people will put up on you. You know, they'll tell you, you're the best, you're the sweetest, I love you, call you doc, all that old stuff. But I want you to notice what happened in the life of our Lord. And we read this morning Psalms 118. And if you want to go to another passage of scripture, I would refer you back to that, because this is just taken from Psalms 118. Since we read it, I don't think that you have to read it, but I want you to notice here. You see, Jesus Christ became a man, and he walked among us, and he had two
natures. He's the only man that had two natures. He said, things have gone bad for me. I mean, boy, nothing has gone right for me. I want to tell you something. Jesus understands the trouble that you have faced in life. Amen. He understands it. But on the other hand, he knows God and he understands God. Look at, Psalms 118, and then we'll bounce over to John's Gospel, chapter 12, and read it there. Psalms 118 makes this statement. In verse 25, save now. That translates the term Hosanna. Save now. And what man among us today, with all of the problems that we face in Iraq, with employment, with crime and violence, and with the family broken down, what man in his right mind today cannot say, oh God, save us now? And that was the accolade that the people said, save now, save King, save Son of David, referring to the fact that he's human. He was of the Son of David, Romans 1:4. He took up on him, amen, the nature of human flesh, but not sinful flesh. Amen. You see, Jesus was a total human being, but he never sinned. And so, save now, I beseech thee, O Lord, I beseech thee, send now prosperity. And then notice in verse 26, blessed is he that cometh in the name of Yahweh. We have blessed you out of the house of the Lord. God is the Lord. He hath showed us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords, even unto the horns of the altar. We read it already. You can look at it if you want to in your own time. Verses 10, 11, and 12, all saying that I will destroy this in the name of the Lord. Go to John chapter 12. Notice, if you will, in verse 12. The next day, much people that were come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. And Jesus, when he had found a young ass, set thereon, as it is written, fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, thy King cometh unto thee, sitting upon a coat. These things understood not the disciples at the first, but when Jesus was glorified, then remembered they that these things were written of him and that they had done these things unto him. You see, what this says is this. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And Jesus comes as the Son of David. And as the Son of David, he is possessed with a nature which causes him to be able to understand your problems, your failures, your guilt feelings. Who among us doesn't have them? Sometimes we don't forgive ourselves. But because of Calvary, Jesus Christ now has forgiven us. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far he has removed our transgressions from us. He's taken my sins, and yeah, incidentally, Otha has some. I'm not saying that I am sinning. You see, the Christian is not sinless. But because of Jesus Christ, he will now sin less. Beloved, I thank God for Calvary today. Because you know why Jesus Christ was crucified? I hope you've seen the Passion Play. If you haven't seen it, go see it. Go see it. If you haven't seen it, go see it. I wouldn't recommend you take small children there, but go and see it. But you don't have to see the Passion Play to know why they crucified him. Pilate came with the oldest text, oldest original script of the Word of God, John chapter 18 and verse 37. And in the context, the oldest original manuscript that has been found, it dates back to 125 A.D. 125 A.D., the oldest, perhaps, original script that they have found. We have nothing of the original text of the Word of God other than this particular text that possibly may be the original text of Scripture. And Pilate looks at Jesus and he says, "Are you a king then?" And Jesus said, "Are you talking for yourself? You said I am a king." In reality, yes, I am. In the book of Mark chapter 15, when the high priest told him, "I adjure you, I put you under oath. Are you a king?" And Jesus said, "I came to bear witness to the truth. And I can't lie before you, high priest. I can't lie before you, Pilate. Yes, my kingdom is just not of this world. Well, if my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants get out there and they would fight." Why was he crucified? The one thing that they blamed against him was he made himself king. And I want you to know something, Pilate. If you let him go with that accusation, you are no friend of Caesar. And Caesar does not like people causing insurrection under his jurisdiction. And when Pilate heard that, he brought him forth and he said, "Behold the man. Shall I crucify your king?" Just 1 week earlier, they had acclaimed him king. I'm not saying that this was all the same group, because perhaps at this time, someone has estimated, there could have been 1 million people walking the streets of Jerusalem when they took those palm branches. And he got on that donkey, that lowest of beast. You have a problem with pride? You're too big to drive a Ford? Huh? Some of us drove mules. We may not admit it now, but some of us drove mules. But Jesus didn't come with a war horse. You understand what I mean? That's what Rome rode. I mean, the power horse. That's what Solomon had in his stable, the power horse. No, Jesus didn't come on a power horse, a war horse. Jesus came riding upon a donkey. And they took those palm branches and they put them in the way. And this is what they said as they took the branches: "Hosanna, save us now, Lord. Save now. Blessed is the King that comes in the name of the Lord." Jesus came as a king. He is a king. And one day, thank you, Ernestine, I dreamed of a city called glory, so bright and so fair. Amen. When I entered the city, I cried, "Holy," for the angels all welcomed me there. They carried me from mansion to mansion, and oh, what a sight did I see. But I said, "Listen, I just want to see Jesus."
Yes.
"This king who died for me. And he died voluntarily." Yes. "He didn't have to die."
Yes.
"He died voluntarily. He took your place on Calvary." Now, Jerusalem had acknowledged that. But we're told in the book of Zechariah 9:9 and Zechariah 12:10 that behold, your king is going to come. He's lowly. He's not filled with pride. He's humble. And he's riding up on an ass and the foal of an ass. And they gave him the accolades. They praised him. They worshiped him. How are you doing in your praise life? I mean, what's going on between Sunday and Sunday? What's going on Monday through Saturday? Is the Bible an integral part of your weekly activities? Do you praise God for the blessings that he has given to you?
Yes.
You know, we African Americans like to gripe and complain, talking about we don't have a job, we don't have any money. A lot of us have jobs, a lot of us have money.
Yeah.
Amen? Now, I'm not derating the fact that some people do not have jobs.
Amen.
And we pray for them. We want to do what we can to encourage them. But what are we doing with our praise and thanksgiving to the Lord? You see, one of the things that I want to put in your hands, it has to do with the challenge for missions. It also has to do with your witnessing for Jesus Christ here. And it's going to cost us something to produce it, but we are producing a videotape so that for those of us who have these big screen televisions, for those of us who have them, if you choose to, you can understand what Islam stands for. You see, heaven to the little boy that had a bomb strapped to his chest, you know what heaven was to him? And this is basically Islam. Heaven amounts to all the fun and pleasure you can have, all the wine you can drink, and 72 choice virgins. That's heaven for them. That's not the kind of heaven that I'm going to. My heaven is where Jesus is. It's where the Lamb of God, who gave his life a ransom for my sins, is. Go to the book of Revelation, if you will, and I'll use this as the last verse that I'll have you turn to. Look, if you will. How much is too much? Look at Revelation. Chapter 20. What is your heaven going to be like? No, it's not all the fun and pleasure, although there will be joy unspeakable. Amen? Yes. John says, and I saw a great white throne in Revelation 20, verse 11. And him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heavens fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. And death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire, that is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth.
For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more seas. And I, John, saw the holy city coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. My heaven is with Jesus.
Amen.
Those who reject him will be cast into the burning eternal lake of fire. But I'm going to go to be with Jesus Christ, my Lord.
Yes.
And Jesus took those accolades. He was God, and he is God. And he went to Calvary to pay for your sins and my sins. And I am totally in debt to him. I don't care what anybody else says. I am in debt to Jesus.
Yes.
I want to live my life for his honor and for his glory.
Yeah.
He has blessed me, and I want to bless others. Bow your heads with me, if you will. If you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, remember this. The Bible makes this statement. He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son of God hath not life. If one has never trusted Jesus Christ as his personal Savior, although water baptism is good, we recommend it after one gets saved. Although giving to the Lord's work is good, we recommend it. Although worshiping the Lord, we recommend it. But those things do not save. It's a new relationship with God. It's a new creation that he wants to perform in your life today. And he will do that if you will simply take this simple verse. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Salvation is just as close to you. Heaven is just as close to you as saying to him, Lord Jesus, I trust you to be my Savior. Father, guide and direct in the invitation, I pray, and just let your name be honored. Bless your word to our hearts. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. The invitation is given. We invite you to stand and come this morning as we sing.
Number 75 in the hymnal, Wounded for Me.
Wounded for Me.
Take your seat. The announcements will be made at this time.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome each one of you, and we thank you for coming to this Sunday School Easter program. We appreciate the parents who are in the audience tonight and also our church members, and we pray that more are on their way. But would you bow for a word of prayer with me at this time? Dear Heavenly Father, we praise your name, and we thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that we receive from you. You give them unselfishly, and although we don't deserve them, Lord, you still continue to bless us. We thank you, Lord, for this time tonight where our children can present poems and things that they've learned about you, Lord, at this Easter time. We thank you, Lord, for the salvation you've allowed us to experience. We thank you, Lord, that you allowed your son, Jesus, to die for our sins, Lord. What a sacrifice that was, and we praise you and thank you for that. Lord, we ask you to bless the children, give them the courage, give them the memory that they need, Lord, to make you proud of them, Lord, as I know you already are. We thank you, Lord, for all those who are participating. We thank you for the directors, Lord, and we just thank you and ask you to bless their lives. Lord, again, we thank you for our pastor and the other officers of the church. We pray, Lord, for each one of them. Bless our entire congregation, Lord. These things we pray in your son, Jesus' name. Amen. Now, at this time, Brian Wright will give us read scripture, Matthew 28.
After the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said."
Today, I see you feel the very same way.
Javon Nelson, happy praise.
Happy praise we bring to Christ the King. I'm glad he lives and new life he gives.
Tiana Hampton, our King.
Happy praise we bring, happy songs we sing,
Where's the life we bring? Jesus is our risen King.
Jayshawn Ellington, thank Jesus.
Jesus sees us, yes, say, for he blessed day.
Micah Manuel, why?
I wonder why God loves me so. I'm sure it's not for what I know, or any work I do, or for creating anything new. My knowledge is narrow, my hands are slow, I'm not known well wherever I go. Though I try, still not doing my best, I often waste my time at rest. Though I may fail, God cares for me, he sent his Savior to set me free. Of all the guilt and things I've done, send Jesus Christ to earth, his only son. He prepared a way of life forevermore for anyone who enters his door. How can anyone possibly know why it is God loves me so?
Kayla Smith, every week, and my best friend.
Hello, everyone. May I have your attention? We are glad you're here today, but let me mention, DC awaits you every week. Let us see your smiling face and a pew each Sunday in your favorite place. Happy Easter. My best friend is Jesus. He'll always be true. He'll stick by my side. He'll help see me through. The way that he loves me is only he can, is most unusual and impossible for man. He died on the cross to save me from sin. Any other way, you just can't win.
Alicia Ellington, how I feel.
How I feel. When I think of Jesus, I'm filling with cheer. When I think of Jesus, I feel warm right here. How wonderful is Jesus who loves all nations, gave his life upon the cross that we might still have salvation.
Chanel Nelson, seek him.
If we seek him, we shall find him. Seek the Christ of light and love. As with disciples Anna and Mary, he will all his promises prove. Seek him early in the morning, long before the breaking day. In the quiet hours of evening, he will abide for aye.
Michaela Manuel, I would know it's Easter.
Even with my eyes closed, I would know it's Easter season. There's a warm glow in the air. I think that that's the reason. People speak so kindly when they meet one another. They seem to feel more Christian and spread love to one another. Yes, I would know it's Easter time, even if I couldn't see. For at this Easter season, God seems very close to me.
Larissa Hampton, Easter joy.
I'm glad you came to God's house this happy Easter day. It's good to show a special love in Jesus in this way. May Easter bring you gladness as Hosanna now we sing in honor of Christ the Savior, our risen Lord and King. There you go.
Jeffrey Smith, why he died.
Why did the Savior die? Why did the Savior bleed? Why did he first suffer? Because he saw man's need. For man committed sin, that's why he needs a Savior who will suffer and die so man could have God's favor. Sin has to be punished. The Savior took man's place on an old splinter cross for man to have God's grace. So the Savior died on a cross in Roman torture state. He did not do this in vain. He suffered for your sake.
John Bronaugh, Jesus loves us.
Jesus loves you. Jesus loves me. Don't
It is in the Bible, don't you see?
Malik Davis, I Love Jesus.
I love Jesus, for he lives. And to others, life he gives.
We will now have selections by the ensemble choir.
As the directress, and let's give Emma another round of applause, please. And the Heritage Choir, of course, always sounds wonderful, so let's give them a round of applause. But tonight, what I think was awesome were those verses that were given to us up here. You notice there were no sheets of paper, So that means they studied and they worked very hard. They wanted to do a good job. And they did. But each one of you, I want you to know, did a wonderful job, and we thank you for your efforts, and we thank you for your love for Jesus Christ, that you would do that. So thank you very much. I want to thank, before Pastor Aiden comes up, I want to thank the three ladies that continue to work with our youth. And I know with the competition that is out in the world that we have to have people who are committed and dedicated to serving the Lord and want to work with our youth, because everybody, the world celebrates Easter in their way. The world celebrates Christmas in its own way. It's become commercialized and materialistic, and we know what it's really all about, and that's Jesus and our God. And we want to thank Denise and Donna and Cynthia for their efforts and all that they do to work with these children. And I know that if they just sent the verses home, you know, parents would help. But I know when the children are here each week, these three ladies are with them, making them work really hard to memorize. And I, as an educator, I appreciate it when I see children speaking from their heart and speaking from memory, because they're learning those things. And that those verses will stay with them. They didn't just read it off a sheet of paper. So I want to thank these three ladies, and I'd like for them to come forward for just a moment. Our appreciation. But on this cup, it's the prayer of Jabez. And on this one, it says, Lord, help me to dedicate all that I do to you. And this one says, count your blessings. And we indeed want to count our blessings, and we thank you very much for all your efforts. I know Pastor Aiden's going to thank the parents too, but I want to thank you parents for allowing your children to come to the choir rehearsals and also to the rehearsal for our different programs. I know you bring them, you pick them up, and you get them ready for this. We thank you for that, and we continue to ask you to be involved and continue to send your children to church so that they can learn more about Jesus. Because I know with everything that's out in the world, I said this earlier, there's a lot of competition out there, and it's up to us Christians to make sure our children know about Jesus Christ. And if we don't do it, they're not going to get it out there in the world. So we've got to make that effort to make sure the children are here and that they hear about the Lord. So unless Denise has something else, I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Aiden. All right, Pastor.
Don't mind. Now, I don't have a gift to show that I'm not as prepared as he is. But here's a man of God whom I thank the Lord for so very, very much, Deacon Spicer. We love you. You're an educator. You love children. You love people. And you are an excellent example before them. Give Deacon Spicer, our Sunday School Superintendent, a round of applause. Thank you. Thank you. I have to have a slip. But this is a wonderful thing, Denise, that you and Cynthia and Donna have been doing with our children. And I take my hat off to you, and I thank you from the depths of my soul for what you are doing. Those children stood up here and spoke like professors tonight. And parents, you really should be very, very happy for the abilities that God has given to your children. I mean, I know you feel this way. You wouldn't be here otherwise. But this is a marvelous thing. My son has an article in the Wabash paper And he has picked up his PhD degree. He's been teaching now at Wabash for 3 years. But guess what gave him that background? Now, he may not remember to say this, but guess what gave him the background to study in an academic environment and to succeed in life? Now, incidentally, guess what the title of his article is? From Hip Hop to History. And he recounts the story how he went to LA and he was in a hip hop band and they were going to give him a contract with Motown. And while on the plane, he met a man who was interested in Africa and in conversation with the.
Rome is a privileged place for devotion to the martyrs. So many Roman citizens themselves were early martyrs, like here today, we're at St. Cecilia. In Trastevere, she was a Roman noblewoman who was martyred.
The Colosseum was built in the year 80 after the deaths of Peter and Paul. It seated more than 50,000, and its purpose was games, to keep the people entertained. Its shape was slightly elliptical for better viewing. There's some debate about whether Christians were sacrificed at the Colosseum, although there was plenty of brutal stuff going on there.
Out of the 32 first popes, something like 27 were martyred.
Father Jean-Marie Pomerez frequently shows pilgrims to Rome around the Colosseum.
The persecutions were not very long. It is true that the persecutions lasted 250 years, but you mustn't imagine it as 250 years of constant persecution. For example, the first persecution started in 64. It is even believed that it was ended before 67.
The example of men, women, and children who were ready to suffer in the name of Christ, and especially those who gave their lives as a witness to the faith, was exalted by the first Christian writers.
One of the earliest was Tertullian, who said that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of Christians. And by that he meant that the blood that was shed by the martyrs gave rise to new Christians. And the more Christianity was persecuted, the more it seemed to grow. It was like fertilizer. The blood of the martyrs was like fertilizer for the growth of Christianity.
Still ahead, the story of a skeptical investigative reporter and the story of his life. He set out to prove Jesus was a fraud.
Just a few more.
I should have used Preparation H.
Preparation H medicated wipes with aloe, the easy way to cleanse, cool, and soothe. Easier because they're 4 times bigger than Tux pads. Preparation H medicated wipes. Big relief.
We are family.
Rentway's got it going on. With our 100% satisfaction guarantee, you'll always go home way happy or get your money back. At Rentway, you're more than a customer. You're our neighbors, friends, and family.
Looking for a break from taxes? Then look no further than Bedroom Expressions. You deserve a tax break savings event. Now through April 15th only, we're reducing qualifying purchases by an amount equal to the sales tax. That's extra savings on top of our already guaranteed lowest prices. Plus, get no payments and no interest for 1 year. If you need a real tax break, then there's no better place to go than Bedroom Expressions. You deserve a tax break savings event. Offer ends, of course, April 15th.
Glenbrook Hyundai says go ahead. Dare to.
compare. Our Hyundai Sonata with the Honda Accord LX. Hyundai has America's best warranty, including 5 years unlimited miles, 24-hour roads.
I'm on the banks of the Jordan River. John the Baptist used these waters to anoint Jesus in baptism, a rite that is a demonstration of faith and cleansing by God. And 2,000 years later, the message of Jesus continues to amaze us with modern-day miracles.
It's not the River Jordan, but it is the way this church baptizes its newest members.
We like to define it as turning irreligious people into fully devoted followers of Jesus.
We rise and walk new lives.
So many people come through our doors because they're at a point of pain in their life.
The numbers alone tell this story. Associate Pastor Gene Apple of the Willow Creek Church in suburban Chicago is successful at spreading the word of Jesus.
We have anywhere from 18 to 20,000 that will attend our weekend services. The message of Christianity hasn't changed in 2,000 years, but it's putting it in a way that they can relate to it. We believe that there is compelling evidence that this person who died and rose from the dead, that's a compelling piece of evidence that people have to wrestle with.
It's a struggle this former Willow Creek minister knows well. Meet Lee Strobel, an investigative journalist and author of The Case for Christ. He took the ultimate leap of faith.
I didn't believe that God existed. I thought that if Jesus ever lived, he was probably a nice man and certainly not the Son of God. I lived a very immoral and drunken and self-destructive and self-absorbed kind of a life. I remember once covering a trial where a woman's only daughter, 13-year-old child, had been raped and murdered. And she is pouring out her heart. And inside, I'm thinking to myself, hey, these are great quotes. Man, this is going to be front page. I'm going to get a bonus for this. That's the ugliest truth about who I was. My wife was agnostic. She really had no position for or against God.
Then a Christian woman befriended Lee's wife, Leslie.
One day she came to me and she said, Lee, I've decided to become a follower of Jesus Christ. I thought this was the end of our marriage, and it almost was.
Instead, Lee decided to use his legal and journalistic experience to investigate whether Jesus was a fraud.
I started the investigation by looking at the ancient historical documents that make up the New Testament of the Bible. I found that the documents that make up the New Testament are much closer to the actual events than I ever had anticipated. That the Gospels, the biographies of Jesus, were probably written within 30 years of the life of Jesus. We don't have some huge passage of time during which legend grew up and distorted the historical record.
Lee also found corroborative evidence outside the Bible.
There are about 100 facts about the life of Jesus that historian Gary Habermas has been able to elicit from ancient documents that corroborate the Bible.
But the resurrection, Lee believes, is the linchpin of Christianity.
Everybody in the first century admitted that the tomb of Jesus was empty on the first Easter. The New Testament account is clear that women discovered the empty tomb of Jesus Christ on the first Easter. Now, in the first century Jewish culture, the testimony of women was not considered to be reliable. They were not even allowed to testify in a court of law. So, if these writers of the New Testament were going to try to make up history to try to convince people of something that didn't really happen, they would never say that women discovered the tomb empty. I choose Jesus because I believe that the evidence for the resurrection established that he did return from the dead and thus authenticate his claim to being the one and only Son of God.
And as a result, his life has dramatically changed for the better. So much so that even his then 5-year-old daughter, Allison, took notice.
She went up to my wife and she said, Mommy, I want God to do for me what he's done for Daddy. But I had the rush of reason and I turned from my life as an atheist and committed myself to following Jesus Christ.
Through 2,000 years of history, Christians and Jews have often been at odds with each other. Up next, meet a rabbi and a priest who say they have the answer to all that divides us.
OnStar-equipped 260-horsepower SRX V6 performance SUV. Cadillac. Breakthrough.
Lisa, what happened?
Greg waited until 9 o'clock last night to get started.
That's when my free minutes kick in.
Greg, you're out. Your team should have joined in with Verizon Wireless. Then you could call each other anytime for free. You increase productivity and build unity. You can't do that if you're out.
I thought I was fired.
You are fired, you minute-hoarding clock watcher.
Free in-network calling from Verizon Wireless. Are all your employees in?
Good.
Now he means business.
Verizon Wireless. We never stop working for you.
I remember it like it was yesterday. I was hosting my first big business dinner, and I paid with my Visa card. Turns out I was over my limit. I was so embarrassed, I didn't know what to do. So I got the American Express card, and it never happened again.
Call now for the American Express card. We can take your application right over the phone.
Applying for the card was one of the easiest things I've ever done, and smartest. Because American Express is there for me, whether I'm out shopping or on vacation. I feel better knowing that.
The card has rewards built in. I get a point for virtually every dollar I spend, plus double points at places I shop the most, like supermarkets and gas stations. And I can redeem them for just about anything, from a trip to Rome to a flat-screen TV.
So call now for the American Express card. You can apply right over the phone.
It helped not having a preset spending limit.
It's great earning double points at so many places.
I can call 24 hours a day. That helps.
Call 1-877-376-1226 to apply.
More breaking news around the nation. More global coverage as events unfold. More political reporting, fair and balanced. More Americans choose Fox News Channel over CNN, nearly 2-1. And more than MSNBC and headline news combined. Fox News Channel is the most watched, most trusted name in cable news. Every story, every day, every time. The choice is clear. America's first choice is Fox News Channel, America's newsroom.
Figures in history. So we asked a rabbi and a priest, good friends, for their thoughts on Jesus. They call themselves the God Squad, Monsignor Tom Hartman and Rabbi Mark Gelman.
Jesus is God made man, the second person of the Trinity. We believe that the Trinity, or God, is Father, Son, and Spirit, that Jesus came on earth to live and die for our sins so that he would open up the way to heaven.
Rabbi Gelman, for Jews?
Well, for Jews, Jesus was a terrifically important teacher, a great world leader, but not the Messiah. There's several reasons why the Jewish community couldn't accept that. First, it doesn't accept the idea that God could ever become a person. Secondly, because he didn't end evil in the world. He didn't gather all the exiles, and he didn't resurrect the dead.
Mel Gibson's movie, The Passion, has aroused some anger among the two faiths, a lot of criticism, but perhaps some understanding. How do you take it?
It is quite clear that in the film, Jesus is surrounded by betrayal. Peter denies him three times, and that was his follower. Judas, his follower, sells him out to the Romans. The Romans are brutal thugs and clearly the most evil figures in the movie. It gives Christians a real look at what the sacrificial suffering of Jesus meant, as well as some of the legacy of anti-Judaism, I don't say anti-Semitism, that has come out of the Christian story.
In the Christian community, it's important to understand that even though the film was not anti-Semitic, there are people who are anti-Semites in the world. And if they do anything against Jews, we've got to stand up as mainline Christians and say, this is not Christianity, this is not approved, this is absolutely wrong.
Do a lot of Christians, do you think, have misconceptions about Jews?
Many Jews, I think, were taught, oh, we had nothing to do with the death of Jesus. It was all Romans. It was just the Romans. He irritated the Roman authorities and they killed him. But the truth is that the Jewish leaders were, at that time, were also deeply offended by his claim to be the Messiah. They were deeply offended by his teaching in his own name. And so it is clear, it's absolutely clear, that there were Jewish leaders at the time who wanted Jesus dead.
Is there more tolerance between Christianity and Judaism today than there was, say, 25 years ago? Tom?
Once upon a time, we had a discussion in which Mark looked at me and said, Tom, you believe that Jesus is the Messiah. I don't. When we die, we'll find out. In the meantime, shouldn't we be sharing our songs, our food, our teachings? I want Mark to be the best Jew he can be.
And that's what I want for you, too.
To be the best Jew.
No, no, you know what?
You know, he has a phone number, 1-800-BE-A-JEW.
Well, it's a marketing thing.
How did you ever give up Jesus?
It was a bad mistake. I really don't know. But what we do know, this is what we do know. We do know that it is this friendship that can change everything. It is a friendship that believes that we are not just here to serve ourselves. The message of selflessness that I learned from the teaching of Jesus and, of course, from my faith, and that really is the bond that we take into this season.
There's so many people who need our help that if we don't allow religion to join us together and help out together, we're missing the boat.
When the two of you pray, when you say your prayers as a Jew, when you pray as a Christian, are those prayers directed to the same God?
Yes.
The absolute same God. And if it's in Hebrew, I don't understand it, but God does.
And if it's in Latin, neither of us understand it.
Rabbi Mark Gelman, Monsignor Tom Hartman, thank you. And thank you for watching this Fox News special, Who is Jesus? I'm John Scott. Up next, today's top news headlines.
We have suffered our worst combat losses since the war ended, one with the potential to put in jeopardy the scheduled June 30th handover of power to the Iraqis. Hi, everybody, I'm Geraldo Rivera, and as difficult as it is to say that, today's violence in which at least 9 U.S. and coalition soldiers have been killed is different and I think more serious than anything we've encountered until now. It is more far-reaching in its implication even than the brutal murder and mutilation of the 4 American security guards last week in Fallujah. That was horrible, and it has generated righteous outrage and calls for payback. But Sunday's violence is not more of the same from the Sunni Triangle, not the product of hardline leftovers from the old Saddam regime. The force behind today's attacks on our troops in Baghdad and a coalition base in An-Najaf are Shiites, followers of Muqtada al-Sadr, a 30-year-old radical, fiercely anti-American cleric who's apparently become increasingly emboldened over the last several days. The current wave of violence follows the decision last week by coalition forces to close down a newspaper run by al-Sadr, accusing that publication of printing lies and inciting insurrection.
We can vouch that al-Sadr
is meant Jew.
Yes. The trouble is, of course, that was not the way people in the first century would have heard it, because that was an ordinary name. There's a lot of evidence that somebody, I'm deliberately putting this very vaguely, somebody close to Jesus betrayed him.
There is intense debate about whether Jesus was put on trial by the Jewish priests.
In Mark, we have two Jewish trials, one at night and one first thing in the morning. And we have the same thing in Matthew. In Luke, we have only one Jewish trial, just in the morning. In John, we have no Jewish trial at all. Okay, so we don't have any clear evidence about Jewish trials per se.
Some people argue that the trial couldn't have happened because the priests would never have held a trial on Passover.
I think that the Romans executed him probably summarily without a trial at all, just because he was a public nuisance.
On the other hand, there are Jewish documents which describe the high priest turning in fellow Jews to the Romans.
That there be a consultation in the house of the high priest, what shall we do about this guy, I can very well imagine.
Is it possible that the Roman leadership alone would have arrested him and executed him?
It is clear that he was executed on the order of Roman authority, because crucifixion was a punishment inflicted only by the Romans. And it's possible that it was only Roman authority involved, but I and the majority of contemporary scholars, including Jewish scholars, would say that most likely a very narrow circle of the Jewish ruling elite centered in the temple, whose responsibility was domestic peace, if you will, were involved as collaborators with the Roman governor.
The most intense debate is about what happened next. In every version of the story, the Jewish leaders take Jesus to the Roman military governor, Pontius Pilate, and had to pressure him before he would pass the sentence. Many historians don't believe it.
We have evidence other than the Gospels for Pilate. Josephus talks about him as a thug, a really, you know, in a string of bad governors, he was one of the worst. Philo of Alexandria, who's Jesus' contemporary, writes that Pilate was known for his theft, his venality, and his execution of untried prisoners. Jesus fits into that category without effort.
But the portrait you get of Pilate in the New Testament is that he's almost a saint. You know, he keeps affirming Jesus' innocence, he keeps trying to find a way to release him, and then finally Pilate comes out and washes his hands and says, I am innocent of the blood of this just man, see ye to it.
The gospel writers have every interest in giving the Jewish mob a very major role in Pilate's decision to have Jesus crucified.
Because, goes this theory, if the Roman authorities actually found Jesus guilty of a crime, then the early Christians would appear to be the followers of a criminal.
They shifted the blame and tried to escape the wrath of Rome, so they were cozying up to the Romans at that point.
But there are also some good historical arguments that Pilate might have resisted condemning Jesus, just as the Gospels say he did. If Jesus had become popular, Pilate might have feared that killing him would lead to rioting.
Fortunately, Josephus, the first century Jewish historian, really comes through for us here. He gives us a tremendous background for Pilate. He's got 600 police in Jerusalem. That's it. And during the high and holy festivals of Passover, you have a population of about 200,000. And 600 police are not going to be able to control 200,000.
And the records show that Pilate had a habit of antagonizing the Jewish leaders.
Pilate has no interest politically in saving Jesus.
I don't think Pilate has any interest whatever in saving Jesus. I think he just wants to snub the chief priests.
On the other hand, Pilate also had a habit of finally backing down under pressure. He had done so on at least two other occasions. In this case, the Gospels suggest the priests pressured him by saying that Jesus was claiming to be a king.
He thinks he's a king, and you have to get rid of kings, don't you?
But even those who think the Bible story is accurate say it has been misread and misinterpreted.
It's again the fractional group of the authorities in the temple that all the others who love Jesus don't know about this till it's too late. He's arrested about 10 p.m. on Thursday night. There's no Jerusalem Times, no Jerusalem Tube, you know, prophet from Galilee arrested, film at 11. Luke 23:27 is the verse that is probably the most overlooked bit of scripture in the entire Bible. Jesus is dragging his cross to Calvary, and a great multitude of Jewish men and women were weeping at that time. Now, how could the church ever have tried to collectivize any supposed Jewish guilt on Good Friday? Totally wrong.
Crucifixion was an ugly process.
Crucifixion was the most horrible form of torturing and killing that the Romans had been able to devise, and they were pretty good at that kind of stuff. It meant, right across the Roman world, we Romans run this show, and anyone who gets in our way gets rubbed out, and rubbed out horribly.
What's the charge?
Well, the official charge, of course, is that he's a political rebel against Rome.
Treason.
It is, exactly.
I think what Pilate's actually doing is addressing Jesus' followers. This is a very, very effective way of saying, calm down, guys. The kingdom of God isn't coming this Passover, because people would have gone to bed all excited about the approach of the kingdom and Jesus' authority to announce it, and when they woke up the next morning, Jesus would have been, you know, on his way to the cross.
Two 2,000 years later, Christian pilgrims still come to Jerusalem on Easter and commemorate the day that Jesus was led through the streets to the place of his execution, carrying his own cross.
He was executed probably because of kingdom talk. You know, what kind of a person is it that keeps on getting people aroused, especially poor people, disenfranchised people, with talk about a kingdom or an empire. That's a dangerous person.
In a sense, he gave his life for the least of these, namely the poor, the untouchables, the suffering of people in the world.
And I think the title that's put over the cross, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews, is Pilate's final insult to the idea that the Messiah was going to show up that Passover.
The Gospels say that Jesus hung on the cross for a few hours before dying. We assume of suffocation, since the idea behind crucifixion was that your lungs collapsed under the weight of the hanging body. The gospel stories don't end with Jesus' death. They say that afterwards Jesus is taken down off the cross by his mother and a few others and buried in a rock tomb. Most of his closest followers had fled.
There's a mark of strong authenticity in these accounts because they don't paint a flattering picture of the Magnificent 12. They look more like the Dirty Dozen than the Magnificent 12. I mean, that's just the truth of the matter about the situation. They're huddled in the upper room, quivering, and don't want to come out from behind locked doors because of the Jewish officials. They're afraid that what happened to Jesus could happen to them.
3 days later, the women came to the tomb and find it empty, according to the Bible.
On Sunday morning, they come back to anoint the body and pay their last respects. They see the empty tomb. They see angels at the tomb.
Then Jesus' little group of followers came out of hiding to claim that they had seen their executed friend back from the dead.
You can shout to this, bounce to this, clap to this, just as long as you don't question this. Asking me how God could save a man, raise a man.
They believed that with their whole hearts. And they went from denying, deserting and betraying to being courageous witnesses to a crucified and risen Messiah.
We asked many historians what they thought about the resurrection stories. There are skeptics who say they were added to the story later.
The first question is even more basic. Was Jesus buried at all? Roman crucifixion, the purpose of crucifixion was state terrorism, and the function was to leave the body on the cross for the carrion crows and the prowling dogs. It was not simply that it made you suffer a lot, it meant that you didn't get buried. That's what made it one of the supreme Roman penalties, lack of burial. As I read those stories, I feel terribly sympathetic for the followers of Jesus because I hear hope there, not history.
Quite a few historians we spoke to disagree. They believe something did happen because they say it is hard to explain the survival of the movement for any other reason.
I know in their own terms what they saw was the raised Jesus. That's what they say, and then all the historic evidence we have afterwards attests to their conviction that that's what they saw. I'm not saying that they really did see the raised Jesus. I wasn't there. I don't know what these people saw, but I do know, as an historian, that they must have seen something.
I simply cannot explain why Christianity began without it. I've already said there were many other messianic or would-be messianic movements around in the first century. Routinely, they ended with the violent death of the founder. After that, what happens? The followers either all get killed as well, or if there are any of them left, they have a choice. They either quit the revolution, or they find themselves another Messiah. we have examples of people doing both.
The major difference between all of these characters and Jesus is he's the only one, apparently, whose followers were convinced they saw him alive after he was killed. And that made all the difference.
That made all the difference. As we know, the Jesus movement not only survived, it grew, and it flourished. Which brings us to a man named Paul. A Jew whose Hebrew name was Saul, and who is famous for having a dramatic encounter with the risen Jesus on the road from Jerusalem to Damascus. After the stories of Jesus' death and resurrection, it is Paul's story that dominates the Bible.
Some have called St. Paul the founder of Christianity. I call him almost the co-founder of Christianity. Yeah, I do, along with Jesus of Nazareth.
It is hard for me to imagine the survival of Christianity in the form we know it without Paul.
Some go even further.
If you are to reflect upon who founded Christianity, it wouldn't be Jesus. If you have to find one person who is the founder of Christianity, that person is Paul.
One thing widely agreed upon is this: Paul did more than anyone we know of to turn the Jesus movement from a small Jewish sect into a worldwide religion.
He is the figure who saw more clearly than I think anyone else that the essence of Jesus's message was good news for everyone.
In the history of Christianity, there has been no more eloquent spokesman for the faith. But Paul started out trying to destroy it. The first time that Paul shows up in the Bible is a scene at the gates of Jerusalem where he is watching a mob stone one of Jesus's followers, Stephen, until he's dead. The Bible says that Paul approved of this.
And it must have looked to any right-wing, hardline Jew as Paul was, that this was blasphemous nonsense. Jesus of Nazareth had been crucified. He couldn't possibly be Messiah. To be a Messiah meant that you ought to be wreaking God's vengeance on the pagan nations, not dying at their hands. So it was obvious that Jesus couldn't be the Messiah.
The one consistent thing that Paul says about his background is that he was a persecutor of the church. He always brings that up whenever he talks about his own life.
Which makes the conversion on the road to Damascus an even more dramatic event.
Peter Jennings reporting, Jesus and Paul, the Word and the Witness, brought to you by Zyrtec, talkbeliefnet.com. Jesus and Paul, the Word and the Witness, continues after this from our ABC stations.
The story is that sometime in the middle of the first century, a Jew from Turkey named Saul had a sudden and bizarre experience while traveling on the road to Damascus in Syria. Saul was heading there from Jerusalem to hunt down and arrest some followers of Jesus of Nazareth, also a Jew, who had been executed a few years earlier as a criminal. Suddenly, the story goes, Saul was blinded.
A light from heaven knocked him from his beast, and he heard clearly while others heard sound. They couldn't make out what it was saying. He heard clearly.
What he heard, according to the Bible, was the voice of Jesus. And upon hearing it, Saul changed. He stopped persecuting Jesus' followers, and instead he joined the movement. We know Saul today by his Greek name Paul, and for later generations, this first century Jewish policeman would become a Christian saint. This is part of the old Roman road that goes from Jerusalem to Damascus. It's pretty beat up by time, and pretty beat up in its day by the constant rumbling of Roman chariots. Now, the Bible says it is on this road where Paul had his sudden and miraculous conversion. This is what the road to Damascus looks like today. We drove to the point on the old road just outside the city where the Catholic Church says the conversion took place.
And precisely what is
it we believe is here, Father?
Father Fernandez is a Franciscan monk who oversees the place. Yes, the Catholic Church says it happened in the vicinity.
C'est la place exactement pour la...
Three other Christian sects claim they control the authentic site of the conversion. They're near Damascus as well, but they're in different places. Father Fernandez says the Catholic case is strengthened because there's also a cave here where early Christians are believed to have commemorated the conversion. The biblical text is very clear, he told us. It says, Saul was turned blind at the doorstep of Damascus and was taken by hand into the city, which means he was in walking distance of the city.
There are some people who say...
When I suggested to him that conversion was a process and not a dramatic moment,
that people didn't get struck by lightning from the sky, that it happened to Paul over a period of time. What do you think of that?
Father Fernandez said, we believe every word that is written. We do not argue with specialists. But specialists argue with one another. Some of them think the conversion did not occur in a single blinding instance.
People who work in the sociology of religion have often pointed out that while conversion is often spoken of in the language of this instantaneous transformation, that in fact it is a process often. People are building to it.
Others think that Paul actually did have a vivid, transforming vision.
What is one to think of the conversion?
The conversion of Paul I take quite seriously. There is a large body of scholarship that tries to take Revelation as a kind of serious event that rational people, one is to respect as rational people, experience.
I think that he had a close encounter of the first kind with the risen Jesus. I think he saw the risen Lord. And that's what he claims over and over again, is that there was this divine intervention. And he had this unbelievable sighting of the risen Jesus.
The Bible also says that Paul was taken into the city and stayed here on a street called Straight. It is still here today. And stayed in the house of a Jesus follower named Judas. While at the same time across town, God was appearing to another member of the movement named Ananias.
In Latin, Domus Animi, house of Ananias. Of course, we have the donation box. If they want to drop something, we'll take it.
Brother Tom Courtney, a former firefighter from Chicago, is the caretaker at this small underground church.